Robin Bhai and all his colleagues who are the young organizers from Keraleeyam of this small family program, and our colleagues of National Alliance of People's Union, Sunny Bhai, CR Medha Kanchan, and others are here, and all of you, my dear respected friends. It's a pleasure to have this dialogue with you all on the day which is International Human Rights Day. And today morning, Arvind Bhakshan and all of us were in the large gathering that was discussing the K-Rail and the struggle against it. You also know that today is the day when the farmers who were staying put with great perseverance and really accepted martyrdom have decided to wind up from the Delhi borders but continue the struggle which is suspended temporarily and is getting into the new phase where the other demands, especially for the support price, I won't say minimum, we need optimum support price for every agri and natural produce will go on. And this is because this movement, which is a people's movement, a social movement, on which much theorization has happened in the country and across the world, and it is proved that the people's movement has its own people's politics, and it is not an apolitical phenomenon. It is also seen that whenever the electoral political system falls short of the requirement of representing the common people of any nation state, and they happen to be compromising and dealing with the issues with the vote banks as their targets, the people have to rise up. The people have to take steps ahead with the mass strength and commitment with micro issues, no doubt, but I also a macro level perspective and a vision. That is what is proved by the farmers movement that began in 2017 when 6 farmers were killed in the Madhya Pradesh Mandsaur district. And we formed an All India Kisan Sangharsh Samiti, and we made 2 demands in our 10,000 kilometer yatra across India. The 2 demands were of minimum support price, but also freedom, total freedom from debt, at least once, that need to guarantee the new beginning for the farmers in this country. And then, friends, the alliance kept on growing, and it became an alliance of alliances, bringing together 550 organizations forming Sanyukta Kisan Morcha. That Morcha stayed put for last 1 full year, and you know that the number of martyrs has gone up to 714. But this movement compelled our great Prime Minister, was not ready to listen to anyone, not ready to have a real dialogue on the real issues with anyone, and was taking a fully pro-corporate position, had to apologize not only to the farmers but the whole of the country. Now there is no doubt that in his statement on repeal of the 3 acts which were imposed during the lockdown period, there is nothing great about that, because in 21 hours, in 20 hours, 21 bills were passed in the parliament during this pandemic, 29 labor acts are repealed during pandemic and 4 courts as weak laws are imposed during pandemic. And when there is no space for even the elected members of parliament to raise questions, with the question hour, which was considered as highly valuable space for raising the people's issues and priorities, it was not expected that these kinds of interventions into the legal regime and transforming it against the constitutional framework of values and directive principles could be countered and challenged within the parliamentary structure and processes. You know how the 12 members of parliament are thrown out, not the one who stood on the table and raised a voice, because everything was and is being done with the upcoming elections in mind. While this is happening in the so-called democratic structures and institutions of our country, and every pillar of democracy seems to be facing or accepting interventions and interference by the rulers of this country, especially those at the center, it was necessary to have a parallel people's political forum. And that is the people's movement, as the farmers' movement has exhibited and proved to be. Friends, even the laborers are fighting in this country. Adivasis are fighting in this country. Because the laws are changed against people and in favor of transfer of resources from those who directly live on the resources as their only life support and only source of livelihood towards the corporates, investors not of natural resources, not of human resources, but only of monetary resources. And those include not just the Indian corporates, but the multinationals that include Adani's, Ambani's, Jindal, Mittal's, Tata's, who work beyond the boundaries of India. But it also includes the international financial institutions, the World Bank, the ADB, the AIIBA, and so on. And bilateral to multilateral agencies are really creating a huge impact and imposition, not allowing even compliance with the laws of our land and comparing the governments to take a position, whether on the development issues, environmental issues, or the economics and politics. And that is where the today's theme, the role of civil society, matters. Civil society doesn't mean the so-called civilized citizens who are in the circle of domain of urbanization and industrialization. Although urbanization and industrialization are equated with progress and development, you know that even today in India, 60% and more of our population live on agriculture and related associated allied industries and trade. And we also know that there are, out of those 60% and more, certain sections which are remaining totally disadvantaged, deprived, and even destitutionalized. May those be the primitive tribes, may those be the nomadic tribes, may those be the Dalits, who are peripheralized even after 70 years of independence in any village or a city, and also large sections, women from various sections who face the cumulative inequality of economic, political, and social discrimination. And it is therefore we and we not just as of contribution of each of these sections, the citizens' sections of our population. Those who are slum dwellers, let's take their example. In Mumbai, 60% of population in that financial capital of India, which is Mumbai, live in slums. They are the real producers. They are the ones who produce every single thing that gives us comforts and fulfill our basic needs. They are the real winners. Those who invest money can never have buildings. Now, if the artificial intelligence comes through, I don't know whether the buildings will be built on the contrary. But when such sections who are really creating and running markets for the poor, 80% of population engaged in to give and take with the hawkers. We fought and fought for the space for the hawkers on the 1/3 of the roadside land. We fought for the hawkers policy and enactment that came up in 2009. We fought for the Adivasis' rights through the Pesa Act. And the Forest Conservation Act was there, but Forest Rights Act came in 2006. Every single act that really was and is today within the constitutional framework of equity and justice really is not complied with. And hence the civil society with these sections at the forefront, who are the real exploited, who are the real Dalits in the largest sense of the term, who are bidding and shoshit, they have to come forward and raise their voice. And that gives rise to not just upsurge, but a movement if it moves and shakes not just the state, the omnipotent state, but also the society at large. And friends, these kinds of movements are everywhere in the country today. Why are the laborers fighting? The laborers who have been the real producers in any textile mill or industry, how far are they getting their due right and space? You read the Supreme Court judgments by Justice V. R. Krishna Iyer, whom we respect and love, who was our closest varishtha comrade. Read the judgments by the P.V. Gajendra Gadkar and some such judges, who said that when a mill or an industry is being run, the laborers should get their due rights. But if any industry is closed down or transferred as business transfer to an agreement, the workers will have the first right to consider taking over the mills. We are fighting for the last 4 years a battle against the Kumar Mangalam Birla's textile mills in the Pradesh. Our trade union, Shamik Janta Sangh, claimed that we need right to employment, not just voluntary retirement, which is in fact involuntary. But what is happening in the country? These owners of the mills and industries, these capitalists, manmani kar rahe hain. Man ki baat batane wale to wahan Delhi mein baithe hain, lekin ye capitalists gali gali mein hain, jo apni manmani se kya nahi kar rahe. If Aditya Birla wants to go into Aditya capital, and Kumar Mangalam Birla doesn't want to run textile mills, but want to go in for cement and real estate and pulp industry, he or they are free to do that. There is no real regulation, monitoring, intervention in favor of the laborers. And when that has been happening in pandemic, it is worse. But the worst situation is going to arise very soon when those 29 out of 44 national labor laws are repealed and the 4 courts are going to be imposed. How can we accept those courts? I plead before the industrial tribunal, the industrial dispute act which is in my bag of 1947 comes to hell. Contract labor act, while every single industry is now changing over to contract labor based industry so that they can be exploited, their toil can be used and misused, and they will be performing more work than others. But not only the staff members, but even the workmen cannot have the salary compared to higher than the, they will have the salaries higher than the contract labor. This kind of discrimination in favor of the owners, the investors, who have only one principle in mind, as Noam Chomsky said it, profit over people. When they are anyway have been moving into this direction, these four courts create such a situation where unionization will be difficult. Going on for a Ahimsak Satyagraha, which is there in the farmers' movement and which has to be resorted to in Narmada movement to laborers' movement. But these courts will make it very difficult to even go on a hartal, a strike, without seeking the consent of the owner of the industry, which will not be obtained easily. The dispute resolution will not come into being. The labor commissioners and the industrial tribunals' role will be different than what it is today. So on and so forth. The women can be compelled to take to night shift, which was not permitted earlier, knowing the role of the mother with respect to the upcoming generation. And when our duty can be accepted rule to be followed by the corporates. No overtime need to be given, even if overtime work is taken from the laborers. It will be the same salary, not double or increased for those overtime hours. So on and so forth. The occupational safety related list of sicknesses is reduced from 105 as ILO, the unit in the United Nations, to the minimum 29 to 30. So a number of changes are brought in. How can the laborers not take to a people's movement, a struggle to save their rights and assert their rights? Every section you have a look at. Women. Uttar Pradesh is a state where 22% of atrocities against women take place. Not because it is a bigger state, but it is a state where the religious fundamentalism to Manuvad is promoted not only by those who have the communal perspective, but also the rulers in the seats of power. And this is experienced by us when we took up, in fact, finding it many, many atrocities in Uttar Pradesh, especially Hathras, which you might have heard of. When that Dalit young girl, with a small piece of land granted to them by the government years ago, was raped and killed, the government in power in front of us was really not cursing, but supporting the offenders, the murderers, the rapists. And even the caste-based organization had come to really unka satkar karne ke liye, to felicitate the offender's family in front of us. You can't imagine, if this is what happens, then the role of the state comes into question. The state has to protect each of these sections and grant them, ensure their right to life, which includes not just physical security,
but right to shelter, right to education, right to livelihood, right to health as well. But we have seen that in each of these sectors, not just the physical atrocities are taking place, but various strategies of discrimination the politicians are engaged in. First of all, they want to be partners with the corporates. And that is why in each sector there is corporatization, not just agriculture. Look at what is happening in the sector of education. The online and offline, the divisions are same as those which were existing openly in the Brahmanic kind of ideological supported sections. Baba Sahib had said that I am not against Brahmins, but I am against Brahmanvad. And that was based on caste, which is again coming into the education sector in different form and with different cause that is in front of us. In such a situation, what is the role of the people's struggle and people's movement? We have to challenge all these forces, which are not just local, which are global. And the globalization, liberalization, privatization policy came into India since 1980s. But that is taken to its peak with even the corona affected population in number, 40,000 crores rupees were taken by the Modi government through 9 agreements that they engaged in with the different IFIs, the International Financial Institutions. But where is the money gone? The private fund, which is called as PM CARES Fund, where is it gone? So what is happening in the country, we have to challenge, and that is what is to be through the people's movement. Unless there is courage and confidence to raise questions which may make you land into the jail. Sudha Bharadwaj is out of jail just yesterday and our people welcome her. A real pro-labor, pro-Adivasi advocate who has always been non-violent and never sided with any persons within or outside family who were in the, who might have supported the Sashastra Sandharsh. But she remained in jail in Kashmir for 3 full years without having proved the false accusations against her. And such is the situation with tens of other social activists. So when you take up a movement and you decide to question or challenge the state, you have to really have the courage, confidence, and that also needs the support. That's why the mass movement, the people's movement, cannot be thought of as an individualistic action without a mass support. Just now we were discussing this, as to what role can we play in today's situation of corporatization, privatization, in the situation of vulgar iniquity, where Ambani and Adani, Mukesh Ambani and Gautam Adani, each of them is earning more than 1,000 crores per day. And our laborer, whether in Manrega scheme or being anyone's farm, is not able to earn even 1,000 rupees per day. What will the domestic servants, our women, do when they have lost their jobs during pandemic due to so-called social distance? We hate this concept of social distancing, which is always to be based on caste and discrimination of this kind or that kind, whether it is on the basis of gender or class. It is physical distancing that one may have to accept during any crisis with virus. But these women are also not getting any support from the so-called state, which is supposed to be responsible for protecting, for feeding each of the voter citizens in this country. And hence, without a movement, without a challenge, we cannot really change this situation full of iniquities and injustices.
I would only say as the last point that when we challenge this, we have to be ready with the alternative vision and also practices. When in Glasgow, the COP26, so much is debated and discussed that Greta Thunberg said, this is all blah, blah, blah. Why so? Because after the Paris Convention, Modiji came back, but opened the 40 coal talks. Even today we have 60% almost of our power generation based on the thermal power. Even today we have K-Rail and bullet train and all mega projects which require energy and the carbon emissions coming out of various actions which consider natural resources as commodities, not life supporting systems. And hence, when the movements really understand that 1500 scientists are warning the humanity, saying that you may not be alive after a few decades, can't we really think of the alternative ways of energy generation? The renewable sources, 40% of energy used in Mumbai is for cooling, not for heating. The whole lifestyle is changing and the whole resource matrix is changing. And this is what is leading to carbon emission. We have to think about how we can be least energy intensive. Not that we don't need energy, but how many lights will heat and how many fans should be on? How can we really control the climate change? With what sources of energy and what technology to be adopted in each of these sectors? Civil movements, people's movements have a role towards this end as well. And hence when the agriculturals, the farmers, agriculturists are in the movement, people like us and our kind of organizations have always been saying that look, farmers do not mean only land owners. We have to include the farm laborers and Adivasis living on forest produce and the Pashupalak, the cattle raisers and dairy workers, and think of every produce that is coming out of nature and the due value to be given to the toil that goes into it, the natural resources that go into it, and the support price that must come through the appropriate magnitude of procurement of those. Kerala is always eulogized and praised for the higher support prices being given to the vegetables, fruits, and everything, paddy, especially in Kerala. But I was listening to Samita today in our meeting, and he was saying that when they held a conference with the farmers, with the present agriculture minister, who had also visited Narmada and stayed with us for 3 months, Mr. Prasad, he was also attending the conference, and some other persons from the government also. And when the farmers spoke out, they really gave the stories of how much unstable are the price systems and the prices in Kerala also. Friends, there are a number of issues that remain to be tackled eventually. And hence the movement has to go ahead and not just ending a program means repealing or reversing back a movement. Program is different from a movement. So we have decided to suspend the actions at the Delhi borders because there is no doubt a great victory in compelling Modi government to repeal the laws, compelling all the state governments with the dictators with debt to take back the false cases filed against all of us with section 307 for the 26th January event where we were not around that and we were 150. The government is also compelled to not pay jal jate hain to Rashtrapati tak for the market. So friends, the movement achieved a number of things.
This movement has also shown, and in Narmada Purvanti Gram, every movement we have experienced, how the participants, citizens, really rise above all kinds of disturbances and discriminations. And that's why when Sanyukta Kisan Mocha had to go to West Bengal, it was because there was an attempt by the electoral politics, to really divide them on the basis of Hindu Muslim. And we thought that we cannot keep quiet, we have to reach there. So civil society, when it gets engaged into a movement, it is not just the directly affected people, whether by K-rail or a dam or a project. They have to be supported by the advocates, the media persons. Writers, cultural activists, and all those intellectuals who share the ideology and agree with the Ahimsa Satyagraha strategy of the movement. I appeal to you all that today when the K-rail is an issue, it is not just to counter or challenge the present government with the help of the opposition parties. No. It is beyond party lines, challenging the so-called infrastructure with the finances coming from the JICA kind of bilateral agency and pushing the project worth 1.26 lakh crore as per Niti Aayog's calculations, which is not at all necessary and is dispensable, where the environmental social impact assessment has not taken care of, where the NGT and High Court's orders are not complied with, where there is no transparency and accountability. Take up this issue, because the infrastructure in the Western Ghats kind of region is really bringing in landslides, flooding. It is really obstructing the flows, natural flows of water, and so on. And this will really worsen the situation of flooding, which is occurring in Kerala almost every year. And this cannot be pushed at the cost of the real development of the public sector transport, which it should be the real priority, with least cost but maximum benefit to the common citizens of this country. And here I appreciate the role of the media. That's my last point. I think Keraleeyam kind of alternative media can play and has played a role in giving the new space for the people's movements. Now, if I say this, let me tell you, in Maharashtra, today I am really in the social media language, I don't work on it myself, my colleagues put it on my behalf. But I was asked to take a paper in hand, Lok Satta, which is the Indian Express Group's Marathi daily, and they took a photograph and they sent a sentence ki jana andolan ki nas madhyamon ke dwara pakdi ja sakti hai. Matlab, the real way of the real crux of a people's movement can be caught hold of or brought before others through a media, and that media has to be honest, that media has to be self-confident and courageous, that media has to be asserting right to freedom of expression. And this is one of such dailies. So I said, okay, you put that sentence. They suggested, and they requested my colleague to put it on my Facebook page, which is also handled by two of my young colleagues. I don't see the face of the Facebook except in very rare situations. And so much of attack on me by the IT cell which exists in this country behind the curtains, but when they come forward, we realize what it is. So friends, praising any media can make all this thing possible. But we still have to acknowledge the contribution by the medium that Keraleeyam. Keraleeyam gave space not only to Narmada Bachao Andolan, but also to the people's movements at large, not only at the state level, but at the national level.
And I have seen how these committed young media persons are working. They did not have any funds. They had a small little 200 square feet space, and today they are getting transferred into a media house. So that appears to be somewhat corporatized terms. But still, I think they are going to use it for not just salam karne ke liye, gulam banne ke liye, but they are going to use it for training, for adopting various means and ways in this context of globalization, which is making those corporates earn huge money, whether through Zoom or through Google. But the same technology they are going to use, as social media is a double-edged sword. Market uses it, and masses also can use it. I hope and I'm sure that Keraleeyam will play that role, which will be supporting the Dalits, Adivasis, workers, farmers, and also those citizens from amongst you all who would be supporting the people's movement for basic transformation towards equity and justice. I really wish them all a success and appeal to you all to contribute 2% of your earnings per month, if that is contributed to any movement, whether it is a media movement or a mass movement, that would make a hell of a difference. That will not go into mandir or masjid, but that will certainly go into the freedom of expression that Vinod Dua, whom we just lost, Ramesh Kumar, Punya Prasoon Vajpayee, and some such media persons have still held on to. And that is a ray of hope in front of us. Keraleeyam also brings it, a ray of hope, which we must take forward by supporting them in every way. Thank you.
नहीं है ये फैमिली फंडिंग है तो आप इसमें कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट कर सकते हैं, आज ही करना चाहिए ऐसा नहीं है, दे कैन डू इट एज पर देयर ओन थैंक्स गॉड. रेगुलरली 2% ऑफ अवर इनकम किसी सोशल कॉज के लिए देना, ये आप प्लेज दे सकते हैं सबका. हिंदी समझता है लाइक ये लोग बोलते हैं, इनको नहीं समझता है. प्रिफर इंग्लिश, आई प्रिफर इंग्लिश और मलयालम और मराठी.
एवरीथिंग वॉज डन फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट. तो ऐसा भी हो सकता है
आप इनको भी एक अपील करना चाहिए इन काइंड सपोर्ट का, व्हाटएवर यू नीड. आई थिंक मेनी मीडिया पर्संस कैन गिव यू इन काइंड सपोर्ट आल्सो. हमको तो बहुत ज़्यादा पसंद आता है, कपास इकट्ठी करो, गेहूँ इकट्ठी करो, हम जो हरदम सैकड़ों क्विंटल इस प्रकार का अनाज इकट्ठा करते हैं वो हमको शराब पर देते हैं, कुछ बेचकर वो एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव खर्चे में लगते हैं. तो ऐसा भी एक परिवार होना चाहिए, जन सहयोगी हो उनका परिवार, दे कैन बी योर परमानेंट जन सहयोगी, जो हर साल आपको कुछ एक अमाउंट दे देंगे और हर बार आपके बारे में सोचेंगे कि हम इनको क्या मदद कर सकते हैं.
ഇൻഡിപെൻഡൻസ് മാധ്യമങ്ങളുടെ രീതിയിൽ കേരളത്തിന്റെ ഇപ്പോഴത്തുള്ള വെബാണെങ്കിൽ തന്നെ അത് അവൈലബിൾ ഫോർ ഡേയ്സ് എന്നുള്ളതാണ് നമ്മുടെ അതിനകത്ത് പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്ന സംഗതി തന്നെ. കണ്ടന്റ് എല്ലാവർക്കും അവൈലബിൾ ആണ്, അത് എല്ലാവർക്കും അവൈലബിൾ ആയിരിക്കാൻ നമ്മുടെ പ്ലാറ്റ്ഫോം സ്വന്തമായിരിക്കാൻ വേണ്ടി തീർച്ചയായിട്ടും തുടർന്നും റിസോഴ്സ് മൊബിലൈസേഷനിൽ എല്ലാവരുടെയും സഹായം ഉണ്ടാകും പ്രതീക്ഷിക്കുന്നു. നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നതിന് വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് കേരളത്തിന്റെ ഓർഗനൈസേഷൻ ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ് എക്സിക്യൂട്ടീവ്
വേദീകരിക്കുന്ന വ്യക്തികളെ, കേരളത്തിന്റെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഈ പരിപാടിയിലേക്ക് ചേർന്നിരിക്കുന്ന പ്രിയപ്പെട്ട മനുഷ്യരെ, കേരളീയം പ്രവർത്തനം ആരംഭിച്ചിട്ടും 24 വർഷം പൂർത്തിയാക്കുന്ന ഈ വേളയിൽ പുതിയ ചുവടുവയ്പ് എന്ന നിലയിൽ കേരളീയം മീഡിയ ഹൗസിന്റെ നിർമ്മാണമാണ് ഔപചാരികമായി ഇവിടെ നടന്നിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഇതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായി ഈ പരിപാടിയിൽ പങ്കെടുത്ത എല്ലാവർക്കും കേരളീയത്തിന്റെ ഭാഗത്തു നിന്ന് നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുക എന്നതാണ് എന്റെ നിക്ഷിപ്തമായ കർത്തവ്യം. കാലം ആവശ്യപ്പെടുന്ന മാറ്റങ്ങളിലേക്ക് നടക്കുന്നതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായാണ് നമ്മൾ ഇവിടെ ഒത്തുകൂടിയത്. ഒരുപാട് പ്രതിസന്ധികൾക്കും പരിമിതികൾക്കും ഇടയിൽ നിന്നുകൊണ്ട് വളരെ ചുരുങ്ങിയ സമയം കൊണ്ടാണ് ഇന്ന് ഈ പരിപാടി ഇവിടെ സംഘടിപ്പിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഇന്ത്യയിലെ അറിയപ്പെടുന്ന മനുഷ്യാവകാശ പ്രവർത്തകയും പരിസ്ഥിതി പ്രവർത്തകയുമായ ശ്രീമതി മേധ പട്കറാണ് കേരളീയം മീഡിയ ഹൗസിന്റെ നിർമ്മാണ ഉദ്ഘാടനം ഔപചാരികമായി നിർവഹിച്ചത്. സിവിൽ സമൂഹം എന്ന പ്രതിപക്ഷം എന്ന വിഷയത്തെ അധികരിച്ച് സംസാരിച്ച ബഹുമാനിയായ മേധ പട്കർ പങ്കുവച്ചതും തുറന്നിട്ടതും വലിയ ചർച്ചകളാണ്. മുഖ്യധാര രാഷ്ട്രീയ പാർട്ടികൾ അധികാരത്തിന്റെ അപകർഷണങ്ങൾക്ക് വേണ്ടി കടിപിടി കൂടുമ്പോൾ രാജ്യത്തിലെ പ്രതിപക്ഷമായി ഉയരുന്നത് സിവിൽ സമൂഹം എന്ന കാഴ്ചപ്പാടാണ് ശ്രീമതി മേധ പട്കർ പങ്കുവച്ചത്. നിരന്തര പ്രതിപക്ഷമായി നിലനിന്നുകൊണ്ട് ശ്രീമതി മേധ പട്കർ നടത്തുന്ന പോരാട്ടം നമുക്ക് ഊർജം പകരുന്നതാണ്. കേരളത്തിന്റെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഈ പരിപാടിയിൽ പങ്കെടുക്കുകയും സിവിൽ സമൂഹം എന്ന പ്രതിപക്ഷം എന്ന വിഷയത്തിൽ പ്രഭാഷണം നടത്തുകയും ചെയ്ത ശ്രീമതി മേധ പട്കർക്ക് കേരളീയത്തിന്റെ ഹൃദയം നിറഞ്ഞ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. കേരളത്തിനും കേരളീയത്തിനും വലിയ രീതിയിലുള്ള സംഭാവനകൾ നൽകിയ അറിയപ്പെടുന്ന പരിസ്ഥിതി പ്രവർത്തകനും പോരാളിയുമായ സി ആർ നീലകണ്ഠൻ സാർ ഇന്ന് ഈ അവസരത്തിൽ നമുക്ക് വേണ്ടി ഈ വേദി പങ്കിടാമെന്ന് ഏറ്റിരുന്നെങ്കിലും ആൾക്ക് പ്രത്യേക സാഹചര്യത്തിൽ ഇവിടെ നിന്ന് പോകേണ്ടി വന്നു. ആളുടെ അസാന്നിധ്യത്തിൽ ആൾക്ക് ഞാൻ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. കേരളീയത്തിന്റെ ഉപഹാരം നൽകി മേധാദീദിയെ ആദരിച്ച കേരളീയത്തിന്റെ നെടുങ്കൂണം കോർ കമ്മിറ്റി അംഗവുമായ റോബിൻ ചേട്ടന് ഈ വേദിയിൽ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. ഇതുവരെ നടന്ന ശീലിച്ച വഴികളിൽ നിന്നും മാറി നടക്കുക എന്നത് ആയാസകരമായ ഒരു കാര്യമല്ല. എന്നിരുന്നാൽ കൂടിയും അത്തരത്തിൽ ഒരു വെല്ലുവിളിയെ ഏറ്റെടുത്തുകൊണ്ട് കേരളീയ മുന്നോട്ട് വയ്ക്കുന്ന മൂല്യങ്ങളെ അടിയുറച്ചു നിന്നുകൊണ്ട് തന്റെ സർഗസിദ്ധമായ രീതിയിൽ കേരളീയത്തിന്റെ പ്രവർത്തനങ്ങളെ മുന്നോട്ട് നയിക്കുന്നതിൽ പ്രധാന പങ്കുവഹിക്കുന്ന കേരളീയത്തിന്റെ എഡിറ്റോറിയൽ ബോർഡ് അംഗം കൂടിയായ ശ്രീ എസ് ശരത്താണ് ഈ പരിപാടിക്ക് സ്വാഗതം ആശംസിച്ചത്. ശരത്തേട്ടന് ഹൃദയത്തിന്റെ ഭാഷയിൽ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. പരിമിതമായ ചുറ്റുപാടുകളിൽ നിന്നുകൊണ്ട് ഇത്തരത്തിലൊരു പരിപാടി സംഘടിപ്പിക്കാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞത് കേരളീയം കൂട്ടായ്മയുടെയും വളണ്ടിയേഴ്സ് അസോസിയേഷന്റെയും മാധ്യമ പ്രവർത്തകരുടെയും കർഷകരുടെയും കലാകാരന്മാരുടെയും വലിയ രീതിയിലുള്ള പിന്തുണ ഉണ്ടായതിനാലാണ്. അതിനാൽ തന്നെയും ഭവനങ്ങൾ സമ്മാനമായി നൽകിയ അരവിന്ദാക്ഷൻ, റസാഖ് ബ്ലാക്ക്ബെറി, ഉമർ ടീച്ചർ ഇത്തരമൊരു ഉത്തരവാദിത്വം എന്നെ ഏൽപ്പിച്ചതിനും